a background on myself and kind of where I'm coming from, so you have a little bit of expectation to what this presentation is about. Currently, I am a 7th grade math and science teacher at a charter school in San Diego. I teach to two classes of students, and I share those two classes of students with a teaching partner who teaches humanities at the school. And so we kind of have a lot of flexibility over that schedule that we do and how we share those students. And our school's approach is all around project-based learning, which I'll get into a little more later. I teach actually at High Tech Middle Chula Vista, which is going to be one of 13 of the schools that we have in San Diego County. We range K-12. We have a total of 3 campuses. One's based right down on the border, which is where I'm at, so the border of US and Mexico in San Diego. You can actually see Mexico from my classroom. It's quite beautiful. We have one, our original campus in Point Loma, which is right next to the airport in San Diego, and then one that's in North County, which is as you're leaving San Diego, going up to Orange County in LA. Our schools, we serve a diverse student body. The students that apply there are chosen based solely upon their application and a zip code based lottery system. And so that helps us to kind of diversify our student population. We're also a Title I school, so we do serve an underserved population of students. And additionally, we have the first fully accredited graduate school embedded within a K-12 organization, which I'm also a student, and that's where my presentation is really coming out of. I'm going to be talking to you about the work that I've been doing over the last couple of years with regards to the graduate research I've been doing around that, which all stems around developing makerspaces in schools. At my time teaching, I guess it would have been about 4.5 years now, I came up with the concept of developing a makerspace at our school. Got the ball rolling on that, started working on that, and have done several consultancies for developing makerspaces on our various campuses, as well as a couple of other schools outside of our organization. The school I work at, like I said, we really focus around project-based learning, which, how many educators do I have here in the house? All right, excellent. Okay, how many people here are familiar with project-based learning? Okay, cool. So about half of you. Excellent. So project-based learning is really focused around this idea that students design, create, develop solutions to complex problems or projects. And through this process, they develop end products. These can range from anything from like websites to some of the, I don't know, the crazy moving vehicles you see around the school, to pamphlets and books, whatever the project is centered around. And these are all focused around learning the core academic content within their classrooms. These can be single disciplinary, multiple disciplinary. It's based really on the school, the teacher, and the application of the material. And through this, the students really learn through doing the work. It's not like, you know, when you think of doing a project in school, if you've been to a more traditional setting, as I have, where you kind of learn the material and at the end of it, we do a project, or you presented a science fair or something like that. The idea through project-based learning is really, you know, we're going to learn about nutrition and healthy eating through developing a movie for kindergartners. And so it forces the students to learn that information through the process rather than front-loading. And within our school, one of the key focuses that we've been looking at with project-based learning is this idea of deeper learning. Our organization, along with several other schools around the country, networks of schools, as well as the Hewlett Educational Foundation, has been looking into this idea of deeper learning. And deeper learning is it's a large umbrella term for the skills and competencies necessary for students to be ready for real life, for real world jobs and civic skills. And it's based on a set of 6 competencies. These 6 competencies I've listed over here, but the first one is really around mastering the core academic content necessary for whatever the class is that a student's based in. The second is gonna be critical thinking and problem solving. How well can the student approach a problem, come up with authentic solutions to that problem, and then solve additional problems as they arise in the work that they're doing. Students through this process need to work collaboratively, communicate effectively through that process of collaboration, whether that's they're agreeing on solutions or they're arguing about solutions and coming up with, you know, unique conglomerates of all of the reasoning in their groups. they are engaged in self-directed learning. In essence, they're really learning how to learn. So one of the things we really try and promote within our schools is teaching students how to gain and access information on their own outside of the teacher. The teacher sort of serves as a resource and a guide for this material, but isn't sort of the end-all be-all source of that knowledge. And then lastly is this idea of developing an academic mindset, really just confidence that a student can do this, that they can learn this information within the context that it's given. And so the work that I've been doing is really based around this place that we call the Maker Lounge. This is the communal makerspace that I've been developing down on our campus for the last 4 years. My campus consists of an elementary school, a middle school, and a high school. So we serve K through 12. We have about 1,000 students total between all of those schools that we're serving. And originally, this idea began in like 2012 through some conversations, the actual development of the space in about 2013. And then where we decided to actually convert an old facility storeroom on our campus into a makerspace. We began that whole process with the purchase of a laser cutter, full-size laser cutter, and we figured that that would help the work that we're doing there. We wanted to figure out how we're going to make that happen. So we started developing this space, and since then, I've been working on further developing it, adding new tools, adding new resources, teaching teachers how to use it, providing access, and then constantly modifying, changing it, trying to make it better for all the students and teachers at our campus. And that's really kind of segues into the graduate work, what I've been looking at there. And so the problem I found with this space is that there was a lot of initial interest into the development of this space. People really wanted to have it. They liked the idea of having somewhere they could go and do and have the tools and resources that were really hard to contain within a classroom. I mean, our laser cutter is the size of like a small Fiat and wouldn't necessarily fit in the back of your classroom real easy, but we needed somewhere that we could have that so students could have access to that. What I found is once we got this and we started developing it, that overarching interest was perpetuated by certain teachers. Teachers that were constantly engaged in making their classroom work, like there was a handful of them that were just in there, that were using it, that were learning how to do it. But a lot of the teachers who had said, yeah, I really can't wait to get this going, to learn how to make this happen, to do this, simply weren't using it. And that was kind of a challenging concept for us. And so we wanted to know, how can we make this better? How can we make sure that we can get more teachers in this? The overall effect of that is that because not every student goes to every single teacher at our campus, there were students who were getting access to this space over time through multiple teachers. But there were also students who would go several years without ever being introduced to it, ever getting into the space, ever getting to use it in their classroom. So I really wanted to work on changing that. How do you make that happen within an organization? How do you make that happen within a school? And so in order to improve this space, I've spent the last 2 years looking at how new teachers experience the use of the space. So how someone who's never used the space before perceives it initially, and then what the development of that thought process is over the time of them getting introduced to the space, getting trained on the use of the space, using the space for the first time by themselves, and then ultimately implementing that in their classroom. Additionally, I also wanted to seek out student perspective. So a student who's using this space, what is their perceived notion? How is this improving their academics? What impact is this having on their education? So those are kind of the two focus areas I really broke my research down into. And so for this, I decided to focus on a sixth grade teaching team at our school. We're a pretty small school, and so I really wanted to kind of hone in on a specific target audience. The sixth grade teaching team I looked at was similar to mine. Two teachers, two classes of students that are shared between them for a year long. They were doing a project that they started and implemented last year for the first time, called Archaic Arcade, where they investigated different ancient civilizations, as well as the evolution of gaming through history, and then had to develop their own unique games that would teach their users or players about this civilization that they were researching about. Last year, they did the project for the first time, didn't use the makerspace at all. I really kind of pushed the teachers this time and said, you know, this is something that would help to improve this project this year. You guys have expressed wanting to do X, Y, and Z, and I really think it can happen through this. I'm also need a guinea pig for my research. You guys want to join in? And so, you know, they agreed. And that's who I spent my time focusing on. My collection of my data really looked around kind of three main aspects. Obviously, interviews and discussions with the teachers, interviews and discussions with the students about their experience, as well as general classroom observations, observations of students through their projects, and then observations of students using the space initially and then kind of through the development of that. And then final conversations with the students at the end of this and the teachers capturing this whole experience for you guys. The actual aim of my research was how to develop a makerspace to support teachers' ability to affect student engagement and deeper learning. And in doing so, I think that I've started to answer that question, but more importantly, I think that I've been working on answering this greater question of, if you're a teacher or an educator who's interested in bringing making into your school, how do you go about this and how do you make this happen successfully? What I found out through this is that the use of the makerspace greatly increased student engagement in the project and the process. I had the opportunity to interview students who had done the project last year, who are my current students this year, and I know would give me completely honest feedback about their experience with this. And just the level and excitement of the students' experience in this project was much, much greater this year with the use of our space, the tools, the materials, the resources. And I was able to gather and find and collect evidence for each of those six deeper learning competencies that I talked about. And so, whether that is through the evolution of the project or through direct use of the space, I think those two things are a little bit intermingled, but I think that's okay. I think that there's this greater improvement, and I think that it's really evident that the use of the space brings students in, gets them excited about what they're doing, and gets them engaged in the work that they're doing. And more importantly, through this engagement, I had a couple focus students who were initially, one in particular stands out. He was a student who really struggled with math, and because of that, just didn't apply himself in a mathematics classroom. His peers knew this, and so he was always kind of seen as that student who, like, oh, he's part of my group, we're gonna have to help support him, we're gonna have to help hold him up. But what he found out through this project is they had been introduced to the use of our laser cutter, and he discovered that he had really good 3D and spatial reasoning, which really helped him to design some of the things, more complex parts and solutions to some of the problems these students encountered and their work that many of the other students struggled with. And this was quickly picked up on by his peers, and thus in the classroom his status was really elevated. This has had a lasting effect on the student, like I've witnessed post-project and the way he approaches class and the way his students approach him. And so, while I think this obviously is just one student I'm focusing on and kind of looking at, I do think it's an important aspect to understand that not every student is going to take academics the same way. And some students can be really skilled and be very successful at some of these civic skills and job career skills that are necessary to complete projects in the real world. And because of that, a makerspace can really help to support those students. I don't think that every student needs to go to college, but I do think that there is something out there that every student can be successful with, and that's part of my job, is being their teacher and helping them discover that. What are they good at? What can they be good at? What are they ultimately going to do? In looking at the students themselves, in looking at the teachers, I saw they're really excited about engaging in this project. They're like, yes, we wanted to use the space. We didn't really know how to go about it. We kind of struggled with it. But in introducing them to what all was to offer, the process they were going to go through and how they were going to go about it, there was this hesitation or this sort of overwhelming feeling of, man, I got a lot to learn before I can actually implement this in my class. That's something that really stood out to me, and I'm very curious about still to this day, like, how do I improve that process with teachers? How do I take someone who's not a maker like myself, who's not comfortable using these things, and make them feel like this is approachable, it's something they can do, it's something they can investigate? Additionally, I was really struck by how much these teachers use these different resources and training materials that I've developed for the use of all of our tools and machines and different things that we have in our space. I initially developed them as training resources for the teachers, teach them how to use it, and then the teachers would implement this in their classroom and use it whichever ways that they saw fit that connected with the work they were doing. However, I saw that not only did they use it for themselves, they immediately pushed it to their students and were using it with them, and that was an exciting thing. And it also sort of really made me like reflect on the importance of developing those resources with multiple audiences in mind. Like, how do I develop something that's going to be successful for both a teacher and a student? And how do I provide the structures necessary to kind of like implement that within a classroom? And then the last thing I saw was that the physical size of our space, being that it was an old storeroom, has a great impact on the way it can be used, as well as it's also kind of adjacent to a lot of the classrooms in our school. And so that proximity to the classroom has an impact on how a teacher can go about using it and what sort of structures have to be in place in order to be able to bring about half of their class there at a time, because that's about all the space can support. And so I've been very, very cognizant about what can I do to improve that given my limitations that are challenging me. Some of the takeaways I've kind of been hitting on these already, but this idea that in order for a makerspace to be successful, it needs to be fluid. I mean, what I mean by this is that your initial concept, if you're the person developing the space or implementing this or bringing the idea to the table, is going to be much different than the actual way it's going to be developed and built and used within a school. And not only that, but the space needs to be continuously evolving to the needs of the people using it, not so much just to the perceived notion of the person who's developing the space. And I think that's where I've seen a lot of spaces be used less successfully than others. I've seen a lot of makerspaces be developed and used by a select few as opposed to a great many, which is ultimately where I'm trying to get ours going. As I mentioned, this need for really well-developed training materials and resources and protocols can't be understated enough. I think that's would be the first place I would start after you identify like what kind of space I want to build, what I want to have in it, is starting on how am I going to get people ready to use this. And ultimately, you need somebody to be able to do that. I am the teacher that was kind of took on this position and challenge. However, I do teach full time. I don't think I'm the optimal person for that in a given setting. That being said, I think that my greater interest in it has really helped to kind of support and float this. But if you're an administrator or somebody who's looking to do this on your school setting, really consider identifying a dedicated person to that space to make that happen, to develop this stuff. Because it's a full-time job. There's no easy way to state it. You know, tools need maintenance, protocols need to be developed, things need to be overseen, and ultimately the use of the space needs to be monitored. So just something to consider. And then lastly is the impact that I hope this space would have on the student learning experience has been visible through my work. I've seen it have great impact on a wide variety of students. I've seen every single student that I've talked to about using the space has taken away some really valuable skills from it and ultimately developed a much greater sense of confidence about just their approach to solving problems in the future. And I think that's huge. If you can do that in your classroom, regardless of the academics that a student's taken away, you're helping to develop someone who's going to be successful later in life. And so I think that's really, really an important part of this. Moving forward, I'm planning on taking this information and continuing it. I want to look at other teachers, other classrooms, other students, how they're using the space, and then ultimately use this to guide and develop the facilitation of our space. I want our space to be constantly evolving. I have a lot of ideas about changing around how the space is used, what it looks like, where it's at, or not where it's at, I can't really change that part, I'm sorry. But ultimately, like the layout of everything and how you go about getting access to it. And then obviously just continuing, I've been doing this over several years, but visiting other spaces and getting new ideas, fresh ideas. I've been at the Maker Faire for the last 4 years now, and the main reason I come is just because of the onslaught of ideas that you get from other people, other industries, and that's huge. And then ultimately, my end goal is to develop all of this as resources for other educators interested in doing this. There's a lot of interest in this, and I've been working on developing this website, the makerlounge.org. This is a collection of the research that I've been doing, as well as the resources and training materials that I've developed for students and our staff at our school. One caveat I will say is that this site is still under development. It should be completed by around June and will continue to be evolving. It's sort of the culmination of my master's work this year. But please feel free to visit it. There's definitely the skeleton laid out. There's a bunch of really great information there. But if you're someone who's interested in developing a space, look at this and then continue to look at this in the near future. Feel free to send me any questions or things that come up after this. But at this point, if there's any questions from the audience, I'd be happy to take them, answer them.
No, we actually
since the beginning, her question was, do we have shop at our school? Do we have applied tech classes at our school? We have not had those since the beginning. The teachers that have been interested in implementing those or that have been doing that have been trying to do so through their classrooms themselves. And that was a big sort of kickstarter for the development of the spaces to be used for teachers to be able to engage their students in those skills that we found have kind of been dissipating from general ed for a while now. And it, ultimately, if you go and you read some of the actual written research that I've done, which you'll find on that site, that's a big portion that I get into about. But
hey, yeah, great talk. Some of the really cool tools in the Maker Movement can be fun, but dangerous. Did you have any, worry from the parents about the legal risks or the physical risks? How did you overcome those risks if you saw it presented?
Yeah, I mean, I start every year, even before I developed this, the number one thing I tell my students and my number one concern is safety in the classroom, and I think that's been a foundation for this. Obviously, many of those tools and machines and things can be dangerous, and so, which gets back to that emphasis on developing really good resources, materials, and protocols for the use of all of that. And then just being mindful on, as long as you teach it right, students are, and monitor it right, students are going to continue to use that correctly. I've had even kindergartners down there using our laser cutter so far, and it's been really awesome to see. It does take additional monitoring in that, but and then also being cognizant of the things that you're choosing to use. So, for example, we're going to get a table saw, and so we went with saw stop. You know, it makes sense. So if you're in that position, just being aware of that.
Money. How many needs did you have to break? What did you guys do to be able to fund something like this?
Well, this may be another reason that I continue to say that Makerspaces should be viewed as an ongoing development. Unless you're just sort of given carte blanche to a checkbook, it's really hard to develop one from the get-go exactly as you want it to be and be functional. That's why I would say I would start with the things that you're interested in doing, the machines or tools that can greatly enhance that, and kind of building a foundation for those and finding ways to fund them. We've gotten funding through various grants that we've applied to. I'm constantly on Donors Choose. We've used sources such as Kickstarter and GoFundMe, as well as developing partnerships with various outside companies. So our school's connected with Qualcomm, which has helped. I've reached out with Autodesk. Autodesk supports education amazingly, so if you're looking for digital resources, check them out. Just putting it out there. We have a $60,000 CNC router that we got donated because some guy was closing down a sign-making business after he retired and wanted to make sure it went to good use. And the only reason we got that was just because I emailed a ton of people. So be persistent, don't give up, and constantly looking for new things. So.
Any other questions?
For the two you have in your Makerspace, what is the most popular one?
As of right now, I'd probably say our laser cutter. It affords, part of the reason for it is it affords you the ability to be able to do the majority of the development use of the machine within your classroom. You can use computers to digitally design the materials you're doing. You go down to the space, it's not a whole lot more challenging to use than a printer or a plotter once you have that basic foundation. And overall, it's a relatively safe tool. It's got a lot of safety functions built into it, so that way it's fairly difficult for students to get in a position that they could get injured by the thing. It also gives the ability to teachers to provide that a level of precision that's kind of unmatched by many other tools. If you want to get really good at being accurate with constructing things out of wood, there's a huge learning curve to just simply learning how to cut a piece of wood with whatever tool you're using. Well, laser cutter, if I put in something, a measurement, it's going to be accurate to that to about 8/1000ths of an inch, regardless of my background skill with the machine. So I would definitely put that on the top of the list. Also, just our general wood shop tools that get a ton of use. Miter saw, sanders, drill press, those kind of things. Those are the workhorses of any Makerspace, I think, and they are of our school.
We have time for one or two more questions. Thank you, Kyle. Oh, is there a question here? Never mind. No? One more question.
Yeah, one here.
So, we had just created a Makerspace at our school, and I feel that I'm struggling a little bit in how to
entice other teachers to come in? They have such a busy schedule and they have these wonderful ideas, but do you have any ways of how to motivate teachers to come in?
I mean, I won't lie, I think that's something that I still am finding challenges with, but the main way I'm going about this is trying to work with teachers that are using the space to provide really great examples of work that can be done. A big thing of what I'm doing here is taking pictures of the different work and stuff that I'm seeing here. I'm going to be presenting it at my staff when I return on Monday and showing them, like, hey, did you know you could use this machine to do this? Have you seen this? You know, try and inspire those ideas, develop this curiosity, and then ultimately trying to reduce that that hill they have to climb in order to access and use the space, I think, is really important. And being persistent with it, that's something that's really helped me. You know, if I see a teacher doing a project, I'm involved in giving them critique or feedback on the development of that, trying to like, hey, this could be really good to use here. And I think a lot of teachers are just simply unaware of the way these machines and tools can be used to enhance the work they're supposed to do.
Thank you everybody for coming. Thank Kyle. Appreciate it. Very much so.
I'll be around over here if anyone has any additional questions for coming.
Yeah, we'd love to have you talk to Kyle. We have another talk in about 5 minutes with